attracting your enemies. We don't want no part in weapons that mass destruct. There is no excuse. Time to disarm your nukes. Let's ban nuclear bombs together.
Okay, welcome everyone. I hope Andrew for
I'm done with these feelings. It's true, I can't stop calling you late.
Apologies, YouTube kept playing. So hello everyone, and thank you for joining us tonight for Ray Acheson's book launch, Banning the Bomb, Smashing the Patriarchy. We hope you enjoyed that awesome remix and the little bit that I left playing there of Outkast. So that was a remix of Rihanna's song Umbrella from the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, or ICAN, and is titled Don't Want Your Nuclear Umbrella. I'll put the link in the chat in case you want to see it again or missed it. My name is Vanessa Lantaine, and I am the National Coordinator of the Canadian Voice of Women for Peace. On behalf of the organization, we'd like to thank everyone for joining us tonight and to our co-sponsors of the event, Science for Peace and the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom Canada. I just want to go over a few logistics for the event. It will be an hour and a half and will include a question and answer period after Ray's address. We will be using the raise hand function if you have a question, or you can also put it in the chat. So please keep your microphones muted so we don't interrupt the speakers. And this event is being recorded. So if you would not like to be pictured, kindly turn off your video. But if you don't mind, we'd love to see your lovely faces. My coworker Ashwini and I will be managing the chat. So if you have any questions, you can feel free to put them in there and also introduce yourself. As always, this is an inclusive event, so please be respectful of everyone on this call. So Vau is very honored, very honored that we are hosting Ray's book launch event tonight. Ray's work at Reaching Critical Will is incredible. And if you haven't checked it out yet, I highly encourage you to do so. And we'll put a link in the chat. We are big fans of Ray's here at Vau. We actually awarded her the Shirley Farlinger Award for Peace Writings in 2014. So before we get into the program, I'll just introduce Vau in case some people on here are unfamiliar. Vau was formed in 1960 to protest nuclear testing, and we have continued to advocate for more than six decades to abolish nuclear weapons and to promote a culture of peace by amplifying women's voices. Vau just recently held our Mother's Day for Peace Award ceremony, showing appreciation for 10 incredible peace builders doing work around the world. I'll drop a link to the YouTube video in the chat in case you missed it. We are also working on a number of initiatives which you may be interested in, and you can find out more on our website, www.vaupeace.org. These include being a leading member in the No Fighter Jets Coalition, the New Canada-wide Peace and Justice Network, a peace education community of practice, and we will also be hosting at the end of the summer our annual peace camp. We also participate every year in the Global Days Against Military Spending and the No CANSEC peace protests. We are a national organization that is membership-based, so if you would like to support our work, we highly appreciate it, and we'll drop a link in the chat where you can become a member or donate to Vau to support our work. I am now privileged to hand it over to longtime activist and inspiration Phyllis Creighton to introduce our partner, Science for Peace.
It is with great, am I unmuted?
We can hear you.
It is with great pleasure that Science for Peace is working with its closest ally, the voice of women, in this important seminar. We're in for a special treat. Ray Acheson is an outstanding Canadian. We welcome her as one of us. Ray came from Pickering to the University of Toronto to do peace studies. So we welcome her as one of our own at the U of T, where Science for Peace has its own office. Science for Peace has benefited from Ray's research already, since Rob Acheson, her father, has for many years led our Science for Peace working group on nuclear weapons, which studies the risks, political influences, and campaigns on nuclear weapons needed, and engages actively in the issues. Concern about nuclear weapons was always at the center of the work, study, and discussion in Science for Peace from its early days in 1981. Ray's engagement in the work of the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, work that won the Nobel Peace Prize in 2017, was a vital contribution for the success of the humanitarian appeal of Toronto Setsiko Thurlow, a survivor of the 1945 atomic bombing of Hiroshima, in achieving the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. With all of you at this webinar, I'm eager to hear Ray's account and to learn about the history and the art of the campaigning we urgently need to do.
Thank you, Phyllis. I will now hand it over to Teja.
Thank you, Vanessa. So I'm going to be talking for Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, Canadian section. We have been operating since the 1920s. We are a small but active group for group of women spread all across Canada. We have more of an active group in Vancouver, but a lot of us are in Nanaimo, Ontario, many of us, and we continue to grow. We are all committed to advocate for peace, disarmament, housing, security, and various other issues that affect each and every one of us in Canada and all across the globe. And if these issues resonate with you, I encourage all of you to join us and join WILPF Canada. You can find out more about the issues that we deal with on our website, which is wilfvancouver.ca or WILPF Canada, and you will find us under both the names. You will also find us on Instagram, Facebook, and soon on Twitter as we are increasing our social media presence. We talk about international and local issues, so definitely do come and join us in these conversations and the Zoom meetings, and participate as we talk about these issues, local and international. Our Zoom meetings, if you do become a part of our group, once you become a member, they are held on the fourth Sunday, PST, 2 p.m. And the next Zoom meeting will be on June 27th. WILPF Canada is pleased to co-sponsor this event and join forces with Voice of Women. We thank them and the staff for organizing this special event. And together we stand against the war and the bombs. And together we also stand in solidarity for peace and world and for peace around the world, sorry. And congratulations, Ray, for this new book. I'm super excited and definitely going to order it. And I haven't. I'm definitely going to do it though. And I will now turn it to Allison to introduce WILPF International and Ray, who I'm sure doesn't need introductions, but you know.
My job is made easy. thank you. Hello, everybody. Good evening, afternoon, or possibly even morning for a few of you, depending on where you're joining in from. Yes, I've been asked to say a few words about WILPF International, its disarmament program, Reaching Critical Will, and finally to introduce Ray. For those who don't know, WILPF was founded in 1915 when women came together in The Hague to discuss solutions to World War I. They founded WILPF as an organization with a mandate to challenge militarism, patriarchy, and capitalism as the roots of war and violence. 106 years later, we are going strong and growing by the day. WILPF is now present in 49 countries with 32 national sections, including Canada, 12 groups, around 40 staff, and thousands of members worldwide, many of whom I see on the participants list right now. Our international offices are in New York and Geneva, which facilitates our involvement in diverse UN processes and fora. WILPF International has four main programs. Peace Women works on the Women, Peace, and Security agenda. There's a human rights program, crisis response, working primarily with women peace builders in the Middle East, North Africa region, and disarmament called Reaching Critical Will, which I will tell you more about in a moment. But we also have projects exploring violent and militarized masculinities, feminist political economy, and the environment. So WILPF created Reaching Critical Will, or RCW, in 1999 to lead the organization's analysis and advocacy for disarmament, for the reduction of global military spending and militarism, and the investigation of gendered aspects of the impact of weapons and of disarmament processes. We monitor and report on UN disarmament fora and processes that cover nuclear weapons, autonomous weapons, the use of explosive weapons in populated areas, the international arms trade, small arms and light weapons, and cybersecurity. We represent WILPF in the governance bodies of ICANN, the International Network on Explosive Weapons, and the Campaign to Stop Killer Robots. Reaching Critical Will consistently brings a feminist approach and gender analysis to weapons issues. And in that way, we have published diverse resources that really examine and lift up the gendered impacts of weapons and of armed violence, while also advocating for policy responses that address those impacts and for more gender diverse participation in disarmament. Turning now to Ray, you know, people always say it's a pleasure to introduce somebody. In this case, it really definitely is a pleasure. I first met Ray around 2008-2009, just a quick anecdote. Ray was already working at WILPF with Reaching Critical Will. In fact, Ray may be WILPF's longest running staff member. And at the time, I was with an organization called Religions for Peace, helping to grow their disarmament program from a focus on cluster bombs and small arms issues to doing more work on nuclear weapons, which at the time I knew nothing about. And everyone was like, oh, you need to talk to Ray Acheson. Find Ray Acheson, talk to Ray Acheson, and you can learn about nuclear weapons. And I was like, well, who is this mysterious person? So I tracked Ray down, got on the elevator in the office building that we shared, and went down to WILPF's offices on the sixth floor and met Ray, where, just as everyone had indicated, they were not only able to help me learn more about nuclear weapons issues and nuclear disarmament, but also became a very good friend, and after that, my colleague. And so my point is that already in 2008, 2009, Ray's knowledge and passion for nuclear disarmament was well recognized. Ray now directs Reaching Critical Will, and in addition to the program work that I described earlier, Ray is also active in supporting work against the arms trade, prisons, and border imperialism, and for advocating for social and environmental justice. Ray is the author of many papers and articles challenging weapons, militarism, and war from an intersectional feminist perspective. They write occasionally for The Nation, have been interviewed by Democracy Now! And Al Jazeera, and have given a TEDx talk on nuclear abolition. Ray has an honors BA from the University of Toronto, as we have heard, and an MA from the New School for Social Research in New York. They are currently a visiting research collaborator at Princeton University's Program on Science and Global Security, and the recipient of numerous awards. And Ray also has another book in the pipeline that will be looking at the connections between different movements for abolition and state violence. So I'm really excited to see this book launch tonight. I've read parts of earlier drafts and know how much time and heart Ray has put into writing it. I've lived parts of it as well. This book comes at a time when movements like Black Lives Matter and Me Too have had an incredible impact on public understanding and political commitments, showing the potential for meaningful change that social movements and popular resistance can have on our world. Banning the Bomb, Smashing the Patriarchy narrates the journey of the international campaign to abolish nuclear weapons and developments in feminist disarmament activism. The story in this book offers a look inside the anti-nuclear movement and its successful campaign to ban the bomb, from scrappy organizing to winning the Nobel Peace Prize in 2017, from conference rooms to karaoke rooms, and finally achieving the landmark UN treaty banning nuclear weapons. So Vanessa, I don't know if it's back to you or over to Ray, but thank you.
Thank you, Allison, for that wonderful introduction. I think everybody is very excited to hear from Ray. So let's hand it over to Ray now.
Thanks so much, Vanessa, and thank you, Allison. Am I echoing or is it okay? It's good?
You're okay.
Yeah. Good. Thanks a lot, Allison. I decided after your Twitter promotion too that you should be my publicist. you're really good at talking up this book. So thank you for that. And just so everybody knows, after I met Allison, I of course stole her from her job later on and brought her over to WILPF. So that was one of my shining achievements, I think. I'm looking at this participants list and it's like, a who's who of Canadian disarmament activists. It's really amazing that you're all here. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. And thank you also to those who are joining from other spots around the world. This is kind of, we pitched this as the Canadian book launch, but it's for everybody, and it worked well for the Australians. It's morning, the future morning for them, so they're all here. And that video that played at the beginning is from ICANN Australia. And actually it was sung by Jem Rimald, who is on this call right now. So I don't think she expected to have to wake up and listen to herself sing a song that she made many, many years ago. But that was done by the Australian campaign. Many of you know Tim Wright and others that are involved there. So they forced all of their friends and partners to join them in a dance routine with the umbrellas. And I am very grateful to them. I laugh every time I watch that video, and I've seen it hundreds of times. I love it so much that I actually included it in the book, in one of the chapters. I like to write about art that people make that really draw us into the movement, that are creative and inspiring and full of joy, because I think that can be something that gets lost when we are struggling or sitting at the United Nations, listening to states lie to us, or dealing with parliamentarians or other political figures who are not living up to our expectations. And organizing can really be a drag. So I like to think about all the joy that brings us together and the collaboration and the spirit of friendship. And so I do write about this a bit in the book. And I'm going to actually start with a passage that references this and then tax on a few different pieces from the same chapter without going through all of it. People have said they like the readings, so I'm going to do another one, but always again appreciate feedback for anybody that's been on more than one of these, if the readings work for you or not. So, to start. This piece of performance art is one of the best in a long list of excellent public stunts ICANN activists orchestrated over the years, in keeping with the original strategy's emphasis on humor along with horror and hope. But it's also a highly accurate account of the positions of the nuclear armed states, as well as those under what is known as the nuclear umbrella, countries that do not possess nuclear weapons themselves, but that include the nuclear weapons of others in their security doctrines. These include countries that are members of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, as well as Australia, Japan, and South Korea, all of which claim that US nuclear weapons provide them with protection. And this, of course, includes Canada. The song highlights the cognitive dissonance around nuclear weapons, that government officials from these countries claim that they want peace but love the bomb, that they simultaneously seek protection from and through weapons of mass destruction. This dissonance and the efforts to shift the paradigm around the dominant thinking of nuclear weapons is what enabled the majority of other governments to move forward inch by inch towards a ban on nuclear weapons. Nuclear-free countries were mounting an increasingly coordinated resistance to the disingenuous, misleading accusations and assertions of the nuclear-armed states. Although most nuclear-armed states and all of their allies had spoken about needing to reduce the role of nuclear weapons in security postures and about their desire to one day eliminate nuclear weapons, it was clear that all of these governments continue to value nuclear weapons and to act in the interest of their perpetuation, not their elimination. Some of these governments exhibited extreme cognitive dissonance about nuclear weapons. They recognized the catastrophic humanitarian and environmental consequences that nuclear weapons cause when detonated. They worried about proliferation because they knew that more nuclear weapons would make the world even more insecure. Yet at the same time, they continued to act as if the nuclear weapons that do exist, at least some of them, the ones that are in the right hands, keep them safe. The incongruity of these positions and policies means that although these governments know that nuclear weapons are dangerous, destructive, and despicable, they want to keep them around because the world is insecure. The tools they see as being the best response to insecurity are those that cause the most insecurity. These governments, by defending the continued existence of nuclear weapons and their inclusion in security doctrines, were saying that they are ready to use nuclear weapons while knowing full well the inevitable results. They refused and continue to refuse to draw the conclusion that the only way to increase security, prevent proliferation, and preclude the unspeakable suffering that the use of nuclear weapons would cause is to prohibit and eliminate these weapons once and for all. The conditions that the nuclear armed states want, such as solving all other international and national challenges, will likely never exist. Are we then to assume that nuclear disarmament is never to be achieved? According to the United Kingdom, we need an environment in which, quote, no state feels the need to possess nuclear weapons. But as has been shown throughout the atomic age, the overwhelming majority of countries in the world do not feel any need to possess nuclear weapons. Those that do feel this need are outliers of the robust international norm against the possession of such abhorrent weapons. So what is this need based on? A need for power, for violent coercion? The rest of the world uses the multilateral system and international law. Why do a few states insist that they need anything more than that? In his History of Scientific Revolutions, Thomas Kuhn argues that each shift in science is hard to come by due to the resistance of scientists to let go of existing theories. He argued that even when they're confronted with severe and prolonged anomalies, scientists are unlikely to renounce the paradigm or theory that they have held for so long until they have a new theory ready to take its place. Those in government policymaking are much in the same position. Despite the fact that their theoretical framework of nuclear deterrence or the effects of nuclear weapons can and have been systematically refuted by the majority of other governments, they cling to their beliefs. Thus, the challenge for advocates for nuclear disarmament is a paradigm shift, which is precisely what nuclear-free countries and ICAN activists were attempting with the Humanitarian Initiative. Suggestions that this initiative or the push to prohibit nuclear weapons are unproductive or unrealistic were meant to distract governments from the reality that the days of nuclear weapons are over. So are the days of the rest of the world putting up with rhetorical commitments to disarmament without any meaningful accompanying actions. The time had come for states to decide if they wanted nuclear weapons to be legal or illegal, for them to exist or not exist. Speaking to the UN General Assembly, the ambassador of Kenya warned in 2013, well before we did negotiate the treaty, "So long as we continue to practice Orwellian doublespeak, we may end up blowing ourselves to extinction." He declared definitively and without hesitation, "It is time states considered a legal ban on nuclear weapons, even if nuclear armed states refuse to participate." So that's the segment I'll read tonight. From somewhere in the middle of the book. And really the book overall, like Allison said, it traces the journey from when ICANN started talking with governments about the idea of building on the bans on cluster bombs and landmines and bringing those lessons into the nuclear field. And it traces it through the UN processes that we did a little bit in the weeds for those that enjoy that type of documented history. But it also tries to keep it pretty accessible and hopefully interesting to those that aren't so interested in those details, and looks at what the sort of systems and structures and values and philosophies around nuclear weapons are. What are the theories of change that we can employ as organizers and in collaboration with governments, like-minded governments, to really overcome the sheer amount of power that is invested in nuclear weapons, in maintaining the status quo, the vested material interests that are embedded within nuclear weapons, the economic privileges that nuclear weapons afford, the capitalist accumulation that nuclear weapons are a part of, the ways in which nuclear weapons are used every single day in order to threaten and berate and control international relations. And the book also, of course, takes a feminist approach and puts all of this in the context of patriarchy, hence the title, And looking at the ways in which patriarchal power was really deployed by the nuclear armed states to try and prevent the prohibition treaty from going forward and trying to shut down opposition to their retention of nuclear weapons and how that still persists today. You know, we've done lots of reading, hopefully, among this group of you know, Carol Cohen's work in the 1980s when she was embedded herself with the nuclear war planners and listened to them talk about nuclear weapons in a really techno-strategic way in a very masculinized language, the way that they talked about these weapons as physical objects. Those still play out in UN conference rooms today in terms of thinking about how nuclear weapons are for power and prestige and the mentality of might is right, how that is deployed in these fields as well. So the book covers a lot of ground. And it goes in, it ends with the negotiations and takes a look at the treaty itself and also then moves from there to look at what ICAN is doing now, what other anti-nuclear organizers are doing, and how we can connect up with other movements for social change, given how embedded nuclear weapons really are in the broader military-industrial complex, but also in other structures of state violence. So I also wanted to chat to all of you, since most of you are working in the Canadian context, about Canada's positions. As most of you probably know, but some of you may not, Canada is a member of NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. And that is really what Canada has used over the last few years to oppose this treaty. In typical Canadian fashion, we haven't been the most belligerently against the treaty. Our government, I should say, has not been the most belligerent. It occasionally says nice things, but then it says the opposite of what it just said, and it does the opposite of what it just said. So it will say that it understands the emotional desires of those who want to ban nuclear weapons, but it's not realistic, and things like that. So it always tries to make it sound like it gets us, but it's just not possible right now to go there. So what's interesting though about it using NATO as its cover, it says it's a member of NATO and NATO has a nuclear strategic doctrine. Over time that has solidified to be this rhetoric that NATO is a nuclear alliance, but it was not always a nuclear alliance. Nuclear weapons do not appear in the founding treaty of NATO. NATO's original strategic doctrines were not nuclearized either. There used to be quite a few countries in NATO that were opposed to nuclear weapons being included in NATO's doctrines. And Canada was one of those countries that spoke out against the nuclearization of NATO. But pressure from the US government in particular, also the UK later on, led these countries, forced these countries into acquiescing to a nuclear doctrine for NATO and also for nuclear sharing through NATO states. So five countries currently have US nuclear weapons on their soil in NATO, but Canada also used to have US nuclear weapon systems. And Sjolv Egeland, who some of you may know, he's a Norwegian scholar. He's done a lot of research on NATO's history and found some great quotes from the time that the Canadian government refused to host US nuclear weapons. This was under Diefenbaker. And the US government responded with an extremely patriarchal attack against him, slandering his government with sexualized slurs, calling him impotent, and saying that he was subject to coquettish indecision and was desiring to preserve Canada's nuclear virginity. Yep. So it's great to have these things on the record. Write everything down. So then the next Diefenbaker's government lost the next election promptly after that, and the next Canadian government immediately accepted the US nuclear warheads, despite public protests across the country. The public was very opposed to this. today, like I was saying, Canada uses NATO and the solidification of the nuclearized doctrine as its excuse not to support the TPNW. It even has gone as far as to say that it understands and supports nuclear deterrence. It said that as recently as October 2020. So any statements that you feel are softening of the Canadian government's rhetoric on nuclear weapons, that one stands in contrast to it. It says it supports the arms control agenda that's been on the international community's table now for multiple decades, and that has not gone anywhere. It champions what's known as the Fissile Materials Treaty, which would stop production of uranium and plutonium for nuclear bombs, except that they haven't been able to get agreement for negotiations of such a treaty, and they've been trying for about 20 years, more than 20 years now. So when the Canadian government says we are looking at more practical measures, what it's actually saying is we're deeply invested in doing absolutely nothing, because that's where it's put all of its energy for the last 20 years. And it can sound like it's really realistic and rational if you don't know what's going on, if you don't know this history, that's actually designed this arms control agenda, this step-by-step approach, pragmatic approach, building blocks approach, stepping stones approach. They've come up with so many names for it. They've repackaged it dozens of times over the years, but it's all the exact same elements. And it can all sound totally reasonable, but it's designed to prevent any meaningful action on actual disarmament, and also to legitimize and reinforce the possession of nuclear weapons in the meantime. It doesn't actually get to the nuclear weapons complex in all of its economic, political, social embeddedness in international politics or national politics. So that's the Canadian government. What about the Canadian people? Well, Anton Wagner, who I think is on this call as well, of the Hiroshima and Nagasaki Day Coalition, he recently commissioned a Nanos public opinion poll, and that found that 74% of Canadians support Canada joining the TPNW, and that 73% even support it if the US government pressures us not to join, which they will, they are. They're pressuring everybody not to join. The Trump administration even sent an unprecedented level to countries that had already ratified the treaty, telling them that they'd made a mistake and they needed to unratify the treaty. So, which is something he's obviously very skilled at doing and wanted others to do that as well. Fortunately, nobody listened to him. But the NATO states are still abiding by US instructions that were delivered way back under the Obama administration to not support this treaty. But of course, that doesn't stop us. We are active in many NATO countries around Europe to crack NATO. That's one of ICAN's kind of big strategies at the moment, is working across multiple countries and in solidarity with each other to see who can be the first to get their NATO state to start being supportive of the treaty. So it's a bit of a race that's on. We're not doing too badly in Canada, but we still have a long ways to go. We have a lot of members in parliament and senators that are supportive of joining the treaty. So that's the good news. And that includes from the Greens, from the NDP, from the Bloc, and even a few Liberals have signed the ICAN parliamentary pledge. We had a Senate hearing in January about the treaty that was hosted by Senator Mary Lou McFedrin, and some of us got to brief the Senate on that. And then Alexis Brunel Duceppe, Heather McPherson and Elizabeth May held a press conference. They're all MPs from NDP, Bloc, and Greens. They held a press conference as well not that long ago on the TPNW, encouraging the Trudeau government to join. There was supposed to be a Liberal at that press conference. I believe they backed out at the last minute. We also, of course, have the amazing Setsuko Thurlow working for our cause in Canada, who I believe is also on this call. Amazing. Thank you, Setsuko, for being here. And of course, she's an atomic bomb survivor from Hiroshima who co-accepted the Nobel Peace Prize on ICANN's behalf in Oslo in 2017. And she has invested so much personal time and energy into trying to get the Trudeau government to do the right thing. There's been appeals from various Canadian peace groups. Many of you are here, so I won't go through all of that. Some organizations, including WILPF, has made submissions to the Human Rights Committee, noting that Canada's positions on nuclear disarmament are inconsistent with its human rights obligation. So there's a lot of support and momentum building, is what I'm trying to say. The obstacle of the Canadian government and successive Canadian governments, this is not just a Trudeau government problem, but it's particularly annoying that it's a problem under this government. And why is it particularly annoying? It's particularly annoying because he says he wants Canada to have a feminist foreign policy, and it's even in the midst of developing this policy, but at the same time is opposing what is the only feminist international law we have on nuclear weapons. So it needs to join the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons if it's going to have a feminist foreign policy. Nuclear weapons are incompatible with feminism. As I was saying earlier, they're tools of patriarchy. They're designed for dominance and control. And you can't rely on weapons of mass destruction for security and claim to be feminist. Canada has proclaimed its values of multilateralism, the rule of law, and yet stood outside of the negotiations that the vast majority of countries in the world participated in to negotiate this treaty, and now stands outside the treaty even as it's entered into force. So this is really unacceptable for any kind of feminist government. So that's why we need you to work for nuclear disarmament, everyone on this call. It's an amazing abolitionist project, and it's connected to so many other systems of violence and control, patriarchal and racist forces. Nuclear weapons are part of the landscape of horror that we need to overturn in our world. They steal money, they exacerbate climate change, they damage the environment, they risk planetary extinction. They're so embedded, as I was saying earlier, in other structures of state violence that there's really an opportunity to plug into nuclear weapons work, regardless of what you're doing. So if you're working on other social justice issues, like climate change, like police abolition, Indigenous rights, Palestinian rights, bringing nuclear weapons into these conversations and discussing how they're connected is really super important. And also bringing those movements and discussions into the nuclear abolition space is equally important. So what are a few practical things you can do? I have some links here that I can put in the chat as I go if I'm coordinated enough to do that. So one thing is, of course, to pressure Canada to join the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. So one of the ways you can do that is by getting your MP or senators to join the ICANN parliamentary pledge, which I'll put that link in. And another way, of course, is letter writing campaigns, petitions, public demonstrations, op-eds, media press conferences. Everything that you can do to put pressure on the government is good. Another really important thing to get at the materiality of nuclear weapons is the divestment campaigns that we have ongoing. So Don't Bank on the Bomb is ICANN's divestment project. And that website that I just posted has information about banks and pension funds and other financial institutions that have money invested in the companies that are manufacturing nuclear weapons. So you can withdraw your personal money from these companies. You can ask your bank to do that. You can ask your pension fund to do that. So for example, here in New York City, where I am currently on unceded Lenape land, we have legislation before the New York City Council to get the city pension funds, so firefighters, teachers, et cetera, all of that money to be withdrawn from nuclear weapon producing companies. So things like that are possible as well to work on. If you're a student, this is something that's obviously much bigger in the US, but probably also applies to Canadian universities as well, is there's often a pipeline from engineering schools or physics or chemistry into the nuclear weapon labs here in the US or into weapons manufacturers more broadly. And so ICANN has a schools of mass destruction project looking at uncovering those links and trying to get universities to divest their educational programs from nuclear weapons. So there's work in that realm that can be taken up as well for the students. So I think I'm going to stop there. Those are just some ideas. There's of course many, many things that people can work on, and anything that we do is really important to be part of this movement for nuclear abolition that is much older than ICANN and will live, I would say, much longer than us, but hopefully we just eliminate nuclear weapons very soon and then we don't have to have that anymore. We can work on other things, but we shall see. Thanks everybody again for being here, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you so much, Ray. That was wonderful. Love the reading. So that's great. So we are about to go into the question and answer period. I would invite people, if you have a question, you can send it along a couple ways. If you go down to the bottom of the screen where you can see the mute, stop video participants, there also is a function to raise your hand on the reactions button. So if you have a question, you can raise your hand. You can also put it in the chat. Either way, we'll receive it. So we did get a question from Natasha, who says, I remember when I was a kid in the 80s that nuclear risks were shown in the news and films. Now I see almost no discussion at all. Can the mainstream media be pushed to bring this back into public discourse? Maybe if I could just add, what needs to happen? Does it there need to be an accident? Does there need to be a scare? How, or can we do this without any disastrous crisis happening?
Yeah, it's a good question. And we certainly don't want there to be a nuclear detonation in order for people to wake up and take this issue seriously again. One incident that did happen recently was the false alert in Hawaii of an incoming missile, which terrorized people across Hawaii and was quite a traumatic event, actually. And there have been some projects that I think will be coming out in the next year. I think a lot of production has been delayed because of COVID, of course. But I know one project that I'm part of is a virtual reality experience that's being put together by some academics at Princeton that have been working with a VR firm. And they have a really great approach, which is to use the experience in Hawaii as the starting point for a discussion about the need to abolish nuclear weapons. So that should hopefully be coming out in January next year. I think there's a few other art and visual projects that are looking at that incident. And so I hope that that's, you know, the last thing that we need in order to wake people up. But yeah, it would be, I mean, that was sort of having it in the public conversation all the time was instrumental to people acknowledging that this issue was still a persistent threat. Oh, thanks, Tamara, just put something in the chat as well. I think that's a different project, but yeah. So I think that, you know, the more that we can do to invest in these projects without having to wait for an incident, the better off we're obviously going to be, because yes, the public perception is generally that this is no longer something we need to worry about. And of course, there's a lot of other things we need to worry about. And so that's why when I'm talking about nuclear weapons, I like to talk about how they're connected to all those other things that people are already worrying about. And at the very core, I mean, the billions and billions of dollars that go into every year modernizing and maintaining nuclear weapons, at the very least, that money could be redirected towards all the other things that we need. And, you know, we had the UK very recently during COVID, during their austerity cuts to the National Health Service and to the nursing budget, decided that they would enhance their nuclear stockpile by 40%. So it makes absolutely no sense in our world to have the priorities that we do. And so bringing nuclear weapons into those conversations, I think, are really helpful to connect it up for people.
Thanks, Ray. Yeah, I think we were all surprised when the UK announced that increase. Like, why now, really? So for the next question, I'd like to hand it over to my coworker Ashwini, who will read a question from the chat.
Thanks so much, Vanessa. Thank you, Ray, for sharing that wonderful insights and answering those questions. I wanted to echo a question from Annie in the chat. Annie asked, what motivated you to get involved with nuclear disarmament? How do we educate youth on this issue?
Well, I was an anti-war activist in high school and in university, and a social justice activist more broadly. But I didn't really start working on nuclear weapons until I met Randy Forsberg, who was one of the leaders of the nuclear freeze movement back in the 1980s. And I did an internship quite randomly with her one summer and got hooked on the issue of nuclear weapons. And so that was sort of my in to have a leader like her to really teach me the ropes of organizing for nuclear disarmament. And I think in terms of making it broadly appealing to youth, I think it really does lie with this connecting it up to other issues. The climate issue is a huge one. I mean, we're leaving a planet to future generations that is going to be increasingly inhospitable and uninhabitable. You know, the fires that we saw across Australia in 2019 and 2020, I think, are like a view into the possible world to come. And so I think the more that we can connect nuclear weapons to the climate change issue, the better off we are. I think also, I hope also, that a lot of younger folks are active today in anti-policing and anti-prison campaigns. And again, nuclear weapons being part of the structures, the philosophies of security through domination, of investments in weapons and violence as the solution to social problems. There's a lot of similarities there. There's also a lot of connections between the corporations that are involved in manufacturing nuclear weapons and the corporations that are building the border wall and the militarization of the border here in the United States, or also in Europe as well. It's the same companies in Europe that are making nuclear missiles for France are also the same ones building drones for the Fortress Europe that's being developed there now. So there's all kinds of these really interesting connections between the work that folks are doing. And I think, just making it clear to people how nuclear weapons are at the core of so much of these structures and philosophies and the way that we've organized society is really important.
Thank you so much, Ray. I definitely agree with the interconnectedness, looking at different issues through disarmament, such as the climate change issues and climate discourse. And I can definitely say I know some of the youth who work alongside me with WOW and Science for Peace, and we're becoming actively invested in these issues. So hopefully we'll be able to take on change in this way as well. There's another question and comment from Florence in the chat. Florence says, in Saskatchewan, small modular or nuclear reactors are being promoted as part of the solution to the climate emergency. I understand that there is a nuclear weapons connection. Could you please elaborate? Thanks for a great presentation.
Yeah, so small modular nuclear reactors are the big new thing that's being promoted, excuse the pun, and they are, they're a disaster. A lot of Canadian activists are actually doing a lot of good work to try and prevent these. But I mean, basically, the connection between nuclear power and nuclear weapons, there's a few, but the essential one is that the same ingredients that are used to create a reaction in a nuclear weapon system is the same fissile material that is used in a nuclear power reactor, which is uranium. So there's the risks there around proliferation of this technology and the devastating effects of uranium mining that also have to go along with this. But the other problems with nuclear power, of course, are the safety and security risks. We've already had enough disasters there between Chernobyl and Fukushima and Three Mile Island and a number of other smaller accidents as well globally. Many governments have, after Fukushima, said it's enough, enough. Nuclear power is no longer considered to be economically viable. It's a massive capitalist project. It really is about profiteering for the corporations that build and manage the facilities. The small modular reactors are sold as like solutions to rural power needs and things like this, but there's been a lot of great work, including by Canadian academics like M.V. Ramana out at UBC, to look into how that's not actually a solution. So I think finding those resources and looking into that is really useful, but definitely not to promote these small modular reactors as a solution to everything. They're a step backwards.
I couldn't agree more. I just wanted to make sure that we got to this question. It came in before the webinar, so I don't want to miss it. I'll put it in the chat as well, just so people can also read it. It says, there has been much silence about Israel's nuclear weapons and its close ties with India, another non-signatory to the NPT. At this time, it is politically advantageous to Netanyahu and to Modi to have an external enemy threat. Clearly for Israel, it is Iran. Israel has made veiled threats. All options are on the table in violation of international law, and it is known that its nuclear arsenal is aimed at Iran. Israel is now reporting about Hamas and Hezbollah acquisition of Iranian weaponry and continues to provoke Iranian militarism, opposition to JCPOA, attacks on the Natanz site, killing nuclear scientists and General Soleimani. How can we as peace advocates and this organization and our organizations call attention to this urgent threat?
Yeah, thanks. We actually, as part of ICAN, there's the Israeli disarmament movement is one of our partners, and they have been extremely active in shedding light and calling attention to Israel's nuclear program, which is not easy to do within Israel at all. It's very risky. But in addition to the work nationally in Israel, Sharon Delev, who's the organizer there, she has also started a project in collaboration with an Iranian colleague called METO, the Middle East Treaty Organization Project, and it's about establishing a WMD-free Middle East. And so they have collaborators throughout the Middle East region, and they've worked directly with governments as well as with activist groups throughout the region to try and promote disarmament. So I'm going to put the link to that organization in the chat, and they're doing just really incredible work and are great ones to follow, I think, if you're interested in that issue.
Wonderful, thank you. And I had another question come in as a message. Why can't a government oppose the TPNW and yet proclaim a feminist foreign policy? In what sense is nuclear disarmament a feminist issue?
So nuclear weapons are about power, control, coercion, dominance, violence, death. Nuclear weapons from their entire cycle create harm for our communities. So from uranium mining, which is usually done on indigenous lands, to nuclear weapon production, which creates a lot of toxic materials as well, to the testing of nuclear weapons, which again has mostly taken place on indigenous lands. In the US, the Western Shoshone Nation in Nevada, they are the most bombed nation on Earth. Almost 1,000 nuclear tests were performed there on their land, but also throughout indigenous lands in Australia, the British tested nuclear weapons there. The US and France have tested, and the UK have tested nuclear weapons throughout Pacific Islands. and the Soviet Union tested in Kazakhstan. And if you look at all of the cases of nuclear arm testing, the testing has been done on the land of indigenous or otherwise marginalized communities. And then if you look at radioactive waste storage, guess what? It's the same thing. Where do they put it all? And they don't, there's no solution to it also. So they just kind of bury it. There's a whole dome in the Marshall Islands, which just has nuclear weapons, nuclear waste under it, a concrete dome. It's just really incredible what we've done to our planet and to the people and plants and animals and water and air for the development of nuclear weapons. So all of this harm, though, is what I'm saying. That's not a feminist project, right? This is the most creation of harm you could possibly have, is antithetical to a feminist policy or a feminist foreign policy, or a policy of security and of safety for people. This is completely opposed to actual real safety and security for human beings. If we look at also the way that supporters of prohibition are treated, the way that survivors have been treated by the nuclear armed states, if we look at the way that activists and organizers are treated, but also governments from non-nuclear armed countries, any of us come into an international space or bilateral meeting with the nuclear armed states, and our concerns are completely dismissed. We're told that we're being emotional, we're told that we're being irrational. All of these are very, very patriarchal techniques in order to shut down discussion. They're ways that a dominant group of people can try and preclude any kind of contestation of their power by ridiculing and making the opposite side seem like they don't really know anything, we don't really know what we're talking about. They're the big boys, they'll handle this situation. So in addition to the weapons themselves being anti-feminist, also the techniques employed in discourse to promote nuclear weapons and to prevent any kind of challenging of the nuclear orthodoxy are anti-feminist techniques as well. And we've seen inside of these discussions within, the national security discourse space, where alternative views try to see the light of day, they're immediately shut down. There's a repression of anything outside of the groupthink. In the United States, in the national security complex, there's actually a group of old white dudes that self-proclaim themselves as the nuclear priesthood. That's what they call themselves. So this is the kind of stuff that we are up against. And all of this speaks against a feminist foreign policy, which would be aimed towards collaboration, cooperation, interdependency, relationship building, and not on it's my way or the highway, or it's, I'm gonna have the ability to destroy the entire planet, so you're gonna do what I say. This is not feminist. So I hope there's more things. I could talk about this for the next hour if you want me to, but I'll stop there because I think there's other questions.
Thanks so much, Ray, for shedding light on some of the harms and talking about the feminist policy and our targets for collaboration and relationship building. We have another question in the chat from Jem from ICANN Australia. Jem says, it's frustrating how concern for the humanitarian impacts of nuclear weapons is dismissed as naive or fluffy compared to the real politic of deterrence. Can you please talk a little more about how nuclear weapons are patriarchal tools? Thank you.
Thanks, Jem. I think I just did. I think this comparison, I think I'll take it in a slightly different direction since I just talked about patriarchy. But this idea of the real politic, yeah, it's like this is the nuclear ideology, right? The sort of the nuclearism, as we call it, this idea that that might makes right, and that nuclear weapons equal power and equal security, and that violence equals strength, and those mindsets, which are extremely patriarchal, nuclear weapons really feed into those structures and approaches to international relations and to domestic politics as well. And then we get to the prevention, as I was talking about earlier, in terms of the step-by-step arms control approach being being like a counterinsurgent type, you know, approach to disarmament. It's a way to prevent us from actually moving forward. That's a very patriarchal approach too of dealing with opposition. You know, we have these terms of like greenwashing and pinkwashing, which is like when corporations or the military puts a little paint on itself and adopts some minor reforms to make it seem more diverse and inclusive or more environmentally friendly, and in the same time is still generating all of the same harms that it's been harmed before. It's just that now more diverse groups of people can kill other people, or the military can pollute, but it can plant some trees also. So all of that, that's, I've been starting to think about arms control in this context as well, that it's sort of the counterinsurgent tactic that governments, nuclear armed governments and their allies use to preclude disarmament from moving forward. And I feel like that is also a very patriarchal move. Cynthia Enloe, a feminist scholar, has this amazing term, adaptive patriarchy. And so she looks at how corporations, you know, we'll have, oh, we have a woman CEO now, so we're all good. And at the same time, they're oppressing women in their sweatshops. So it's that kind of adaptive patriarchy, I think, that's really important for us to pay attention to, especially as we're now in the phase where the treaties entered into force and we're trying to advance it within resistant governments, and to really put them on the back foot, that this is what they're doing. They're doing this corporate pinkwashing, greenwashing, whitewashing, washing situation. I don't know what color the nuclear one would be. Red one, I guess. Red washing. I don't know.
Thanks so much, Ray. And we have another question from Ellen. And Ellen says, the women's movement is very well organized in response to COVID-19 and calling for a feminist, green, just economic recovery. I think we could pose the financial, environmental, and social costs of military expenditures, including nuclear arms versus social sustainability, that could build intersectional feminist support. We would need to create the social media in as a broad-based coalition as possible. WILPF Canada created one for the last election. Do you think the will is there? Have other countries done this recently?
Hmm. Yeah, I think that... I don't know that other countries, other feminists, other women's movements in other countries. That's a good question. And I think this work is ongoing in many locations, yes. I would definitely add in the Red Deal to this as well, which in the US has been a response from Indigenous groups affiliated with the Red Nation to propose adjustments to the Green New Deal that also take into consideration the importance of decolonization, land back, water and land defenders, and those types of movements and initiatives. So I think that any kind of feminist green economic recovery would be really, really important there. As well, and in Canada too. And I think that this is the exact type of thing that's needed right now globally. WILPF International put out some feminist principles for COVID recovery last year. I suppose we were a little bit optimistic about the end of COVID. We put them out last July, I think. So they may need some updating now that things have gone on since then. But I think, yeah, this type of material and campaigns within countries and across countries transnationally are super important.
Great, thank you. So we have another question from Samantha, who asks, why do you think the average, i.e. non-politician, would want their country to have nuclear weapons? What do you think is the best way to help them understand the threat? Excuse me.
Well, the biggest reason that any country wants nuclear weapons is because the nuclear armed states have sold them for so long as these ultimate deterrents and guarantors of security, right? Like they treat them as these magical objects that somehow prevent conflict and keep a country safe. Of course, the world is embroiled in conflict. You know, there's arms transfers all over the place. There's countries that have nuclear weapons that are fighting each other in various proxy formulations. And there's so much violence in other ways, domestically and abroad, in all the nuclear armed states. So we can understand that that's not the case, but this is the rhetoric of the nuclear deterrence philosophy, right? Is that these weapons are essential and important. Well, if you put out there that they're essential and important for you, then they must be for everybody else, right? And this is one of the things that I think, a diplomat from Jamaica said this at one point during the nuclear ban process in a meeting that we had in Geneva, of basically, she just got super frustrated and was saying, well, if you're saying that these weapons are amazing, then I think I'm just going to go home and tell Jamaica that we need to get nuclear weapons. And that, you know, she said it as a joke, obviously, but that's the frustrating thing about it, is the nuclear armed states are the biggest proliferators in the world, even though they invest so much money and energy into their non-proliferation projects and their nuclear security projects and all of those things that make it look like they're doing something on nuclear weapons. But really, they are the biggest proliferators in the world because they hold up nuclear weapons as essential for security. And so the way to break through that is by looking at the humanitarian environmental harms. It's looking at what nuclear weapons did to people in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, what they've done to people everywhere that nuclear weapons have been produced and tested and where waste is stored, and look at the actual harms that they cause, and the cost that they take in order to build up an arsenal and maintain that arsenal, and to look at then the threat that comes with having nuclear weapons, that they don't keep us secure, that they actually make the entire world more insecure.
Thank you, Ray, for your answers. And I think that's one of the most, I would say, exciting parts about disarmament, is that, you know, all of the global funds that go towards nuclear weapons arsenals could be redirected to the green transition, to educating girls, to anything we want. We could really use that money elsewhere. So we are rounding out the end of the question and answer period. I have two questions left. This one's from Tamara. What do Bob Ray, Leslie E. Norton, and Stephen DeBoer, who represent Canada at our permanent missions to the United Nations, say to you about Canada not joining the TPNW? Are there any sympathetic staff who say to you off the record that Canada's position to join the TPNW is wrong?
There have been in the past Canadian mission staff who have been sympathetic towards the TPNW, who regretted not participating in negotiations. Yes, there have been. Are there any in the moment? I don't know, because I haven't been able to physically go to the UN in the last year and a half. So I'm not actually even sure who's working there anymore. And so I will get back to you, Tamara, once I'm allowed back in the building. But no, in all seriousness, I think there have been and there will be. And really, they are key to making policy changes, and not just at the UN mission, but of course, also at Global Affairs Canada, and other affiliates of the government, wherever we can find them, that are concerned. And also former ambassadors, of course, and former representatives of Canada who can speak to this issue. It's always great when they are able to speak out about it, but it's also better to have them saying these things when they're in positions in which they can affect policy, to be saying these things as well. So we're always working on that.
Thank you. And we are at our final question, from Tamara as well. So it says, Ireland beat Canada to get a seat on the United Nations Security Council last year because Ireland was seen as more progressive and independent. How has Ireland been on disarmament, and what are Ireland's positions on disarmament now?
Ireland's amazing on disarmament. Sorry, Canadians, I'm also an Irish citizen. I am a dual citizen. Thanks, grandfather. And so I pay attention, obviously, to what Ireland's doing. It was a champion of the TPNW, one of the core group states leading that process. It's currently leading a process also to end the use of explosive weapons in populated areas, which has been somewhat delayed by COVID, but is getting back underway now. And it was previously champion of other humanitarian disarmament initiatives, such as the landmine cluster bomb treaty. So it's a very active country in terms of disarmament. I think, you know, the council is not a good place for action on disarmament. You have the five nuclear armed countries with a veto over everything. So it's, I don't pay attention to the council because I find it a fundamentally corrupt part of the United Nations. I much prefer the UN General Assembly because every country has an equal vote there and can speak on equal footing. The UN Security Council has been charged with many mandates that could have resulted in progress on these issues, but it never does because the material interests of the P5, as they're known, the permanent five, are so bound up with their power politics, patriarchal power politics, and their nuclear weapons, and their other conflicts and grievances against each other, that it's just not a forum where anything serious can actually get done.
Thank you. Thank you so much for answering all of our questions tonight. What an amazing job. And I will be handing over my talking stick to Ashwini. Ashwini, can you go ahead?
Yes. Thank you so much, Vanessa. So greetings, everyone. My name is Ashwini Selvakumaran. My pronouns are she and her, and I'm the peace campaigner for disarmament with the Canadian Voice of Women for Peace, also known as WOW. It is my pleasure to be able to speak with you all today from Milton, Ontario, which is the traditional land of the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation. On behalf of WOW, we want to offer a sincere thank you to Ray for sharing such incredible insights from their book today. Thank you so much, Ray, for your powerful work and continued activism on disarmament. I'd also like to thank Phyllis from Science for Peace, alongside Tejal and Allison from the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, for all of their help in co-hosting and contributing to this wonderful event today. In the spirit of our discussion on disarmament and sustainable peace, I would like to take a few minutes now to provide an overview of WOW's new campaign, Why Canada Needs an Agenda for Disarmament. Firstly, WOW recognizes that disarmament is the act of reducing, limiting, or abolishing weapons. Disarmament courageously creates the space for reimagining the concept of security and re-envisioning the role of the state. It can also liberate international relations from the threat and use of armed force. Disarmament relies on the sophisticated and nonviolent practice of conflict prevention, diplomacy, and mediation. 3 years ago, the United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres urged member states to make disarmament a priority and launched Securing Our Common Future, an agenda for disarmament. The agenda explains that disarmament can be achieved through measures such as elimination and destruction of weapons, prohibitions and restrictions, non-proliferation education, regulation, transparency and conference building protocols, alongside remediation. Unfortunately, the Government of Canada and the Parliament of Canada still have not performed a comprehensive public study on disarmament. The last time that there was any parliamentary attention to disarmament was over 20 years ago. According to NATO's defense expenditure latest report, Canada's defense spending has dramatically increased over the past 5 years to $30.8 billion, which now constitutes 1.31% of our GDP. Canada cannot afford to meet NATO's 2% target for military spending. This is why WOW is calling upon the Canadian government to make disarmament a political priority and revisit our defense budget. We have recently published a 2-page handout entitled Why Canada Needs an Agenda for Disarmament, which entails some of our key asks. These include developing a national action plan and study for disarmament, which highlights specific actions and timelines, signing the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, and conducting a public analysis of military spending that considers the opportunity costs, among a few of our other requests. You can find the full handout by going to the bottom of our webpage on disarmament and clicking download. I will also send the associated website links through the Zoom chat after I speak with you all today. You can also download our handout by scanning the QR code on this slide with your phone camera if you happen to have your phone in front of you. WOW fundamentally believes that disarmament is essential to maintain international peace and security, protect civilians, and promote sustainable development. It also is capable of supporting the Sustainable Development Goals, in particular SDG number 3, good health and well-being, SDG number 8, decent work and economic growth, and SDG number 16, peace, justice, and strong institutions. Lastly, on Thursday, June 17th, from 7 to 8:30 p.m. Eastern Time, the Canadian Voice of Women for Peace will be hosting a civil society meeting to review our two-page handout and build a grassroots national campaign to get the federal government to create an agenda for disarmament for Canada. We encourage you all to please join our discussion and share your ideas about how we can make disarmament a political priority for Canada. This event will be hosted by WOW and supported by Science for Peace. All are welcome to attend. Please register and share this event with your networks and help us stop the growing militarization of Canadian foreign policy and put disarmament and diplomacy at the center of our international affairs. Once again, I will send all of our associated website and Zoom links shortly after I conclude. We appreciate all the contributions by our wonderful speakers today and our audience members for attending and listening. Please feel free to message me any questions or comments you have through the Zoom chat. I will now be passing it over to my colleague, Peter Sana, to provide some remarks on WOW's No New Fighter Jets campaign. Thank you.
The No New Fighter Jets Coalition consists of several organizations, such as the Canadian Voice of Women for Peace and Science for Peace, World Beyond War Canada, the Canadian Foreign Policy Institute, Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, and a number of other organizations. This coalition is calling on the Canadian government to cancel its plans to purchase 88 new fighter jets for $19 billion. But $19 billion is actually the sticker price. The No New Fighter Jets Coalition has estimated that the full life cycle costs of these new fighter jets from acquisition to upkeep to disposal of the planes would total approximately $77 billion. And former Deputy Minister of National Defense Charles Nixon asserted that purchasing these new fighter jets is totally unnecessary to protect Canada's national security or sovereignty. In the past, Canada has used these fighter jets to kill countless number of innocent civilians in unjust and illegal wars in Libya and Yugoslavia. The government's plans to purchase 88 new fighter jets is not only costly and unnecessary, but also environmentally destructive, as specialized fighter jets at high speeds and altitudes emit significant greenhouse gases. Purchasing these fighter jets means Canada will not meet its commitment under the Paris Climate Agreement. It's worth mentioning that the Department of National Defense is the largest emitter of greenhouse gases, yet the Department of National Defense's operations are exempt from the federal government's greenhouse gas emission reduction targets. Instead of needlessly spending billions of dollars on fighter jets, especially in the midst of a pandemic, that money could go towards investing in public transit, housing, a green economy, and helping Indigenous communities. Recently, more than 100 Canadians across the country engaged in a fast to oppose the federal government's plans to purchase new fighter jets. If you would like to support the No New Fighter Jets Coalition in pressuring the government to cancel its plans to purchase the new costly and environmentally destructive fighter jets, there are a number of ways in which you can get involved. At the moment, we have a parliamentary petition which is calling on the House of Commons to cancel its plans to purchase these fighter jets. We are aiming to reach 1,000 signatures and hope to have the petition introduced in the House before the House rises for summer recess on June 23rd. The petition closes for signatures on June 18th, so it's important that we get 1,000 signatures before that date. You can visit our website, nofighterjets.ca, where a link to the petition is prominently featured, and we will also put a direct link to the petition in the chat. Another initiative you can take part in to support the No New Fighter Jets Coalition is to sign our open letter to the Pope. during Pope Francis's Easter message, he stated that it is scandalous that military arsenals are being strengthened during the pandemic when the poor are suffering. Inspired by Pope Francis's Easter message, our open letters asking for Pope Francis to pray the Canadian government does not purchase these new fighter jets and instead invests in caring for people and the planet. But we will also put a link to the open letter in the chat. On our social media pages and website, we have also been featuring testimonials from Canadians across the country voicing their opposition to the government's plans to purchase these fighter jets. So we encourage everyone to make their voices heard by sending us a statement, emailing us a statement of opposition to the government's plans to purchase these fighter jets. Lastly, the No New Fighter Jets Coalition is looking for new members aged 16 to 24 to join our youth division. As a youth member, you would be able to meet other young activists who are passionate about climate and peace activism, participate in awareness building exercises, build relationships with other student peace groups and peace activists across the country. We will put a link to our Slack channel for those interested in youth who would like to join. And there's no previous experience or knowledge that you require in order to join. And now I'll pass it on to Samantha from Science for Peace, who will discuss the upcoming initiatives.
Thank you, everyone. So my name is Samantha, and I am the president of the University of Toronto's chapter of Science for Peace. So first and foremost, on behalf of the organization, thank you to everyone for joining us tonight. And most of all, thank you to Ray for your valuable contribution on the discourse surrounding peace, security, and justice, which are issues that are simultaneously timely and timeless. So Science for Peace brings together researchers from a range of disciplines to use their expertise to achieve a more peaceful and just future. Throughout our history, nuclear weapons have been a focal point, and we have advocated against their proliferation and use. We intend to continue this important conversation through hosting an online symposium on nuclear disarmament for undergraduate students across the country in the autumn of this year. It is our hope that such an event will not only educate students on the threat of nuclear weapons, but also inspire them to become part of such initiatives such as this. Please do feel free to reach out to me if you have any questions about Science for Peace, and also for any additional information, please look at our website or our various social media channels. And if you'll allow me to conclude on a somewhat sentimental note, I think it can be extremely easy to capitulate to the inundation of really horrible news and give up hope. But as evidenced by everyone here, the very fact that you're here, there are clearly other people who share our commitment to a more peaceful, a more just, and a more sustainable future. So I hope that if this event, if you, like me, often feel extremely disillusioned, events like these, I know they do for me, can really help remind us that this isn't a meaningless fight. There is potential, and for that, I would really like to thank you all for your ongoing commitment to necessary and important changes. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. And as we round out this event, I want to thank everyone who is here today. And I want to thank our co-sponsors and all of the speakers, and most importantly, Ray. We loved your reading, and I think everybody should buy your book. So go now, pre-order. There was a discount code in the chat. So if you do scroll up, it is there. Please buy the book. We're also asking for you to sign the parliamentary petition against the fighter jets, and keep updated on our initiatives for disarmament. It's definitely a topic that we are going to be pursuing, and we want to call Canada's attention to the importance of disarmament and get that study going, get the expert witnesses in, and then be able to hold the government accountable to them. So what a wonderful evening. Thank you everyone for being here. And as we round out, I'm going to play a song. Let me see here. That was requested. I'm just going to, one second. Where did it go? I should not be in charge of this anymore.
I can say a word about it while you're finding it if you want. It's a song from a Canadian band from Newfoundland called The Burning Hell. They're kind of a folk country band. And I asked them to write a song for ICANN in, I think, 2014. And this is a song that they came up with all on their own, and it hits on the themes of stigmatizing nuclear weapons. So it's pretty great.
Okay, wonderful. So we're going to round out with this song. I've got it now. And here we are.
In 17th century France, they used to burn baskets of cats for kicks until people were finally like, hey, let's not do that. It's kind of sick. So we don't do that anymore. Not so long ago, a hemiglossectomy cured a stutter. That meant cutting off a bit of your tongue with a special kind of tongue cutter. But we don't do that anymore. We don't do that anymore. We don't do that anymore. But we're apparently still basically totally okay with the threat of nuclear war. It's a little odd considering all the other crazy stuff that we used to do before. It's high time we didn't do this anymore. Once upon a time, it was totally fine to blind the enemy with quicklime, or catapult plague-infected corpses at castles, or poison the bad guy's wine. But we don't do that anymore. In the First World War, they thought it was a blast to spray the other soldiers with mustard gas. World War II brought me and you things like weaponized botulism and anthrax. But we don't do that anymore. We don't do that anymore. We don't do that anymore. But we're apparently still basically totally okay with the threat of nuclear war. It's a little odd considering all the other crazy stuff that we used to do before. It's high time we didn't do this anymore. I was gonna number all the nuclear weapons currently stockpiled on Earth, but counting to 16,000 seems like a terrible idea for a verse. Or maybe this is a bridge, but whether or not it is, before things get much worse, let's put this purse in reverse. I know it's upsetting, but let's not be forgetting Armageddon. Yet I'm still a hopeful man, and I'm a big fan of the plan to ban nuclear weapons.
All right. Have a great night, everyone. Thanks for coming and seeing with us.
Thank you, everyone.